You're listening to the Vocabit podcast, where I help students improve their vocabulary for the SAT, ACT, and life itself using my unique and research-backed story-based method. On this podcast, I'm sharing the best tips and tricks for a more enriched vocabulary and pain-free test day. Hello, and welcome to episode 48 of the Vocabit podcast. I'm Erica Abbott, a former English and history teacher, the author of the young adult novel Ahead of Her Time, and the founder of the eponymously named vocabulary company Vocabit. So we are starting our little writing mini-series in earnest today. I'm starting to get serious about the sequel to Ahead of Her Time, and I want to pull back the curtain a little bit and bring you guys along for the ride. I would die of joy if my favorite authors did this, and I know I'm not in their league, but hopefully you guys find this interesting. I've jotted down a few scenes for the sequel, but before I really start writing it, I want to take a look at how I wrote the first book and figure out how I can make this one more efficient, and hopefully you guys can learn from my mistakes. I think one of the uniquely cool parts of Ahead of Her Time is that it draws so much on experiences that I've been fortunate to have. They say write what you know, so I think that this is a fairly common thing that we do. A lot of my life is in that book, as I'm sure a lot of your life would be in any book you write. I think that adds an element of verisimilitude, an element of making it feel true. That ver root has to do with truth. Verisimilitude, it's similar to the truth. But the downside to that is that at times it can be difficult to turn your own experiences into a three-act story. There's a formula to good storytelling, and I ended up having to do so many rewrites in order to make this work. I have one book, but I feel like I wrote three because I rewrote literally hundreds of pages. I thought I knew what would happen when I started the book. I knew that Nora would get sucked back in time from the day she started talking to me. I was at the Met with my aunt, and I was telling her how I wanted to write a book or something about ancient history, but I didn't feel like I could do justice to bringing an ancient voice to life. I feel like there are just too many differences. So we started talking about a modern voice in an ancient setting, and that was really kind of when Nora started hanging out with us. I'm going to give away some big spoilers, so if you haven't read Ahead of Her Time yet, go get it and then come back. But anyway, in the first version of Ahead of Her Time, the professor was actually the bad guy. He was trying to send Noor back for some reason I don't even remember. I think he had sinister financial goals. The book had nothing to do with saving her parents. I don't even think her parents were mentioned in draft one. And then in draft two, she goes back, but Julius Caesar is just starting to take over Egypt. And it would give her years to save the library and years to get to know Caesar and everything. And, you know, you'd get to see the scene where Cleopatra rolls out of the rug. And, you know, I actually wrote this entire draft before belatedly realizing, you know, what is Noor going to do in ancient Egypt for years? Because I also wanted to get to Antony. I also wanted to get to the Battle of Actium. So then on the next draft, you know, I basically cut out almost all of Caesar. I rewrote the entire thing to make it just the end of Caesar. And then I also condensed Antony's timeline a bit. But, you know, this is like entire books that I wrote that I ended up having to change. This is all stuff that should have been figured out during brainstorming, not during writing. I think part of the issue is that at the time, I was really seduced by the concept of NaNoWriMo, National Novel Writing Month. It's a wonderful organization. It's helped so many writers. But one of their big things is, you know, just write. You can figure everything out during editing, try to write a novel, do it in a month. You just have to get the words on paper, and that's the most important thing. I didn't actually do NaNoWriMo, but I was kind of seduced by that messaging and to just, you know, just get started. You don't need to have every detail figured out yet. You know, I'm grateful that it helped spur me along to make progress, but this time around, I don't want to be doing hundreds of pages of rewrites. So last time around, I started with an idea, and it was, you know, a fairly well-developed idea, but this time, I am not going to put pen to paper and bring this story any further until I have a 15-act beat sheet, which I'm going to use the Save the Cat Writes a Novel guide to help me refine. That's a book that really helped me clean up the final draft of Ahead of Her Time. I'll link to it in the show notes and the podcast accompaniment. And then, like Elizabeth Peters, and I'll dive into this in the next couple episodes, I'm going to write two outlines. For every book of hers, basically, I found a one-page outline and then a 7 to 15-page long outline. Because you think, oh, I've got this great idea. Modern girl goes back to ancient Egypt. But there is so much more to a book than that. There are so many details to work out. I know there will always be edits and revisions, but for the sequel to Ahead of Her Time, I'm going to try to avoid huge detours, at least, by plotting out each scene a lot more deliberately. For some of Elizabeth Peters' books, you know, she wrote really well-developed mysteries. She sometimes even had a day-by-day account of what would happen. You know, day one, so-and-so gets robbed. She didn't just hope she'd figure it out after she started writing. If you think about it like driving, I was like, okay, I know I'm going to California. She was like, I know I'm going to California, and I know I need to go through these states to get there. Sometimes even she had to make a detour. She talked about how once the person she had picked to be the murderer was obdurately refusing to kill anybody, but at least she had a plan, and presumably it helped in some way because she kept doing it. I don't think that this contradicts my pseudo belief that ideas are living things. Sitting down at the beginning and figuring out, okay, where does this idea go, is still listening to the idea, is still listening to Noor. It's just a lot more efficient than riding off in all directions in the dark and hoping I end up in California. So this weekend, I'm going to spend some time diving into these ideas, really refining them, going through scene by scene what this book is going to look like. On Tuesday, I'll share some of the ideas that I found really amazing during my research of Elizabeth Peters' writing process. On Thursday, I'll share where I am with all of these ideas. If you're writing along with me, Godspeed. If you're not, I'll see you next week, where we're really going to get started on lesson by lesson, step by step. Here's what we're going to do. I'll see you next week.